Alrighty, hello again, everyone, and welcome to it. It's the Daily Caller Podcast, the Friday video interview edition. It is the 6th day of December 2019. I'm Derek Hunter. I am your Mr. Rourke as we prod the mind of somebody much more interesting than I am. This week is no exception, although only just barely. I've mentioned this guy on the show before. I've told you to harass him on Twitter. I'm going to do it again just because it's fun. You know him as Bo Snerdley. The law knows him as James Golden. He joins us now. Welcome to the program, James.
Derek Hunter, my pleasure. Yeah. Finally.
That's right. They said it couldn't be done, or maybe they said it shouldn't be done. I don't remember what they were saying, but they warned against this. Now, I'm not just having you on here to harass you for just the sake of joy, really, of harassing you. You actually did something this week that's very important.
See, that's what happens when you insult me. My phone just went off. Someone saying, "What happened?"
Oh. So your phone is very defensive of you. Hey, you know what? Everybody needs a hobby. Hey, at least you got a friend. Siri won't pick you up from the bar, but at least it'll have your back when somebody's attacking you via Skype. But let's get into what you did this week, because you're all over the news and it has nothing to do with your day job. You're actually doing something very important. You're starting a new PAC, Political Action Committee, to bring the black vote back home to the Republican Party.
Absolutely. And you know what? This is, Derek, what happened, I looked at the political landscape earlier in the year, and I said, I just can't sit out another season, another political season, watching the same racist narratives being used by the left to paint Republicans, conservatives, as bigots and fearmongers. I mean, it was just unconscionable the way, especially if you remember early in the political season before they went off on this impeachment binge, every other week there was some racist angle they were pulling out of the closet, usually over nonsense. And so I decided this time around, I have to just come off the sidelines and jump into the fray. So I founded a political PAC with Autry Pruitt, who is a conservative, a bit younger than I am, but boy, is he sharp. This is a guy that wrote a book during the 2016 election cycle defending President Trump, went out on his own dime to campaign for him across the country. Autry has a background in real estate. He has a background in political matters. Very, very sharp guy. So the two of us have been working to lay the infrastructure for this. And now we're going to rev it up in full gear. We have some objectives.
We'll get to the objectives in a second, but I want to talk about the logistics of this, because I just want to impress upon people that this isn't something you're doing in a couple of hours of spare time and you just decided on a whim to open up a website and fill out a couple of forms. Starting a political action committee is an arduous process. There are flaming hoops that you have to jump through. So this is something that while it's just coming to light now, you sort of glossed over. There's a lot of legwork and thought that goes into this. How long have you really been working on this thing? And talk a little bit about the idea of setting one up, the difficulty of it.
6 months. We've been doing the filings. We've been working on it for 6 months. We've been planning. We've been having so many hours and hours and hours of discussion about the messaging, about how we want this to move, looking at how we wanted to begin the initial round of staffing. And it's only the initial round because we've got a long way to go. And we have a very ambitious agenda. And Derek, thank you for asking that, because most people don't know. You started a PAC. Wow, that's easy. No, this has been already 6 months,
right,
half a year.
Lets people know that you're very serious about this, because most people would look at this and go, 6 months, to hell with it. I'm not going to do it. If I can't do it tomorrow in a Twitter world, if you can't do something in 5 minutes, what's the point in doing it? Whereas to do something like you're launching here, it actually takes a commitment, and it shows a commitment to potential supporters out there that you're not in this for a flash in the pan. You're in this for the long haul.
No. And, you know, in the environment where in some cases people have a little mistrust of political PACs because of some of the ways they've been used, we had to think about that, too. But so we've decided we're going to be transparent with how we do things. We are going to, we are all committed. Everybody that's working with this PAC. And we only have a few people on board right now. And again, our plans are, we're hoping to grow it so that it becomes an institution in every state in this country, especially in states where there are blue cities. But I'll come back to that in a little bit. But yeah, so it took a bit of a commitment. Autry picked up his family from Texas and moved here to Florida so that we could do this. And what I'm telling you, there's a lot of sacrifice that has gone in this already. There's been a lot of sacrifice. But this is so important that we both felt that whatever it is we have to sacrifice, we're going to do it in order to make this happen.
Talk a little bit about the importance of diversifying the black vote. It wasn't always 91 to 7 or 8% for Republicans. It right after the Civil War, it was overwhelmingly for Republicans. That somehow the Democrats got only not only a monopoly, but got a generational monopoly. I grew up in Detroit, as you know. We've talked about this, where someone like John Conyers had been representing an area of Detroit that he'd been there since the earth cooled. And it deteriorated significantly over his tenure. But the idea of the district voting for an alternative, not even just another Democrat, but a Republican, was so far beyond the pale. That's how far the Democratic talons have gotten into the black vote, that a district that now looks like it was Dresden circa 1944 still can't even entertain the idea that maybe the party that caused it to become like that doesn't have their best interest at heart. So you're up against generational muscle reflexes in a lot of ways, muscle memory of people just voting for the D, hunting for the D, voting for the D. How did it get to that point? And what is your plan to change that?
Well, it got to that point because there was no pushback. So for 50 years, very little pushback. Okay, when I grew up in Queens, New York, there was a Republican Party, there was a Democrat Party in my neighborhood. By the time I had left and grown, the Republican Party was long gone, never to be seen from again. Okay, and so you have city after city where there is no Republican presence. There are no conservative clubs. There are no Republicans in the neighborhood. And so what you get is constant messaging. The Republicans are evil. Everything that's wrong in your life, oh, blame it on the Republicans. It used to be blame it on the white man. Now it's just blame it on the Republicans. And so for 50 years almost, we've had this nonstop drumbeat of how evil Republicans are, how they mean to do harm, how they can do no good for you. And the Democrats have been very successful at using these racist narratives and these racist tropes and racist memes against conservatives and Republicans for 50 years. And so what happened? The Republican Party, and I don't mean this to knock on the Republican Party, I vote Republican.
There's a lot of blame to go around, James, and part of the reason that the vote is the way it is because the Republicans have given up the black vote. So attack them right where they deserve it.
So what happens is every election cycle, you get Republicans, oh, let's put $10 million or so in outreach. First of all, it's insulting. Let's reach out to the aliens, to the species over there that are not like us, and do outreach for them. You know what? That doesn't work. You cannot come to people every 4 years and say, oh, we're going to spend $10 million on you, and we're not your enemy. Oh, please vote for us. We're really nice people. If you're not in the neighborhood, if you're not part of people's daily struggles and their daily aspirations, if you don't know who your neighbors are, if you're not demonstrating to your neighbors who you are, then how can you expect them to trust you enough with a vote, those that do vote? Now, you mentioned earlier the shape of some of these cities. And yes, that should be enough. And I think that is what the opportunity is. As you know, the recent polls show that President Trump has got 33% of the vote. Now,
do you believe those polls?
I shouldn't say I do. I haven't seen the methodology, but I think it's possible. And I'll tell you why. I think it's possible because right now you have more black Americans working than at any other time in American history. You know, for the years that Obama was president, around this time of year, there were a lot of black families that couldn't afford Christmas for their kids. Okay? Now people are working and have jobs. Guess what? Kids have Christmas this year. Families have jobs. In some cases, and I don't mean to minimize this, because there are a lot of black folks I know who are struggling and working two and three jobs in this economy to make ends meet. By the way, there are a lot of white people I know that are working two and three jobs in this economy to make ends meet, because that's just the way it is. You work hard if you want to achieve. But what President Trump has shown is that with the right kind of policies, the economy can grow. Obama had kind of written it off. This is the new normal. What you're going to do, wave a magic wand and make everything? Yeah, well, he didn't wave a magic wand, but guess what? Jobs are back because of policies. So, yes, it was vital. Also, don't discount the efforts that the president has made on matters of judicial reform and prison reform. People in the communities see that in various communities. Now, he hasn't achieved everything that he wants to do there, but what did Obama do? What did Hillary do when she's the one that called everybody super predators. Her husband was the one with the crime bill, and all these Democrats who voted for the crime bill are now trying to run away from it. Also, you have issues like school choice. That's a big issue. Derek, I found out just this week, I saw video of something that took place in Florida within the last 2 years. I had no idea this had happened because it was never covered in the mainstream media. Long story short, the NEA, when Gillum was running for governor, Gillum threatened to close a program at the behest of the NEA that allowed 118,000 minority kids in Florida and others to have school choice to go to schools with scholarship so that they could attend grade schools. And one of the things that Gillum did was promise to shut it down, to hurt these over 100,000 black kids in Florida and more, and make sure that it didn't expand. These black parents, 10,000 of them, showed up in Tallahassee to protest and to demand that this program stay in place. Wasn't covered. This was the biggest civil demonstration in Tallahassee, Florida's history, even by black folks, even bigger than anything that occurred during the civil rights years. When the civil rights were, this was huge. It wasn't covered. So when people now look and say, well, how did DeSantis pull that victory off with these black voters? It was about school choice. And this is why this president and the policies that he's working on, trying to do immigration reform against the Democrat backwind of this, with his economic measure, with school choice, with prison reform and judicial reform, all of these things matter to people. So do I believe that it's entirely possible that his numbers are up above 30% among black folks? Yes, I believe it. Because they're doing things that affect people's lives.
It's one thing, James, and I know that your PAC is more focused on long term, but it is one thing to do well in the short term. The 2020 election, maybe if Donald Trump gets 20% of the black vote, it's over. But long term, you're talking not about winning the next election and then going off to the Caribbean, patting yourself on the back, drinking pina coladas all day. You're talking about changing voting habits long term.
We've had years of one party rule in black neighborhoods. We have to change that, okay? And it's not going to happen in one election cycle or two or even three. So what New Journey PAC is about, in the long term, we want to establish a presence in every single blue city in America, every single one. We want to demonstrate to our countrymen to our fellow citizens that conservatives, that Republicans, we are here as neighbors. We are here as your friends. We are here as your relatives. We are here as your countrymen to help, to listen, to do with actions and not words, to demonstrate what kind of people we are and to demonstrate to people that we want the best for every single American. We want the best for every American, regardless of their race, regardless of their sexual identity, regardless of any of those other factors. You are an American. We love America, and we want everybody to have access to the American dream. And so our long-term goal is to be in every single blue city and stay in there until we can convince and stay in there, period, as neighbors, to help.
The key to success to doing that strategy, and I think that's the absolute right strategy, is focusing on the heaviest areas first. But you have to recruit locally. You have to get people from within the communities to sort of rise up and stand up and be brave enough to say, I'm here, you all know me, by the way, I'm a conservative. You know, you have to come out as a conservative. I imagine you know, we talked a little bit about this last year at lunch, but explain the difficulties in recruiting people like that, because in a lot of ways it's like stepping on a landmine. You're coming out as a conservative while people are going to look at you differently because of that muscle reflex, because of the generations of those other people are horrible racists, and then suddenly somebody comes up and says, I side with the racists. That's not what they're saying, but that's the way it will be perceived, and there's a lot of ostracizing going on if somebody stands up and comes out as a conservative. So talk maybe a little bit about how your mother is very liberal. Talk a little bit about how maybe you handled it when you discovered that you were conservative, or how you plan on sort of advising other people, because there will be blowback, especially in the beginning, for people coming out and saying they're conservatives.
You know, the people that some of my friends and my friends' parents in the church that I grew up in, Grace United Methodist Church in St. Albans, Queens, when I first started working with Rush, and then as a few years went by and people started to understand and see me in a very visible role sometimes, well, I was still behind the scenes, but you know what I mean. So, but understand that I was part of the program. So my mother comes to me one day. My mother's a diehard liberal. She was part of the Democrat Party machine in Queens. You know, she's still a diehard liberal Democrat, right? But my mother comes to me one day and she says, you know, some of my friends at church would really like to know what happened to you. what happened to you?
So would I, but that's for different reasons.
So I said, Mom, I'm so happy you asked me that. I said, here's what you tell your friends. You tell your friends that I, as a grown man, am living the values that I learned here in this church. I'm living the values that I learned, Mom, from you and from Dad. I've grown up to now embrace all the things you taught me when I was a kid. And the real question is not what happened to me, but what happened to you.
How did that go over?
It went over well. That was the last time I got asked that question. I'm a diehard Democrat, but even this week, my mom said something to me I thought was really amazing. She said, you know what? I don't like Trump. I didn't vote for Trump. I'm not going to vote for Trump, but I'm sick of the way that these people keep going after him and haranguing him and harassing him.
That's a big breakthrough for your mom, too, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's get down to what you do, because super PACs, what they are and what they do is sort of, it's like boxing a cloud. Nobody really knows what they do. You can't coordinate with candidates. You can't coordinate with campaigns, but you can, you got to pick your races, pick your spots, pick your points to go in. Are you guys going to be doing candidate recruiting and sort of punching up their ability to campaign and briefing them on issues and how to communicate them? Are you going to be running campaign ads on behalf of candidates? Will you be involving yourself in primary races? I just want to know where this thing starts off and where you want to see it, not only where it starts, but where you want to take it.
Okay, here are some of the things that we're going to do. We are going to be in the battleground states, and we are going to be messaging to black folks, right? To black people in the battleground states where the president's victories were very narrow and where moving the needle with black voters could mean the difference between winning and losing those states. And we are going to message about the things that this president has done and the things that their party has not done. And we're not going to do it in traditional ways. I don't want to. We have a few commercials on one of our websites that will give you an idea of some of the ways that we're messaging. And some of those commercials are running. You can hear them on our website, newjourneypack.org. Newjourneypack.org. Okay, so we're going to be doing some of that messaging. But we're also looking at some races outside of the battleground states. We have a brilliant potential candidate that's going to run in a high-profile seat that in Congress that a black person lost last time. We're looking very closely at that race. There are some other people. There's a young man in Florida that we have our eyes on, and if he announces, we're going to totally get behind him. He's brilliant. We're looking at black conservatives that we are going to support. And we want to, there's, I understand, a lieutenant governor in North Carolina that we're going to be taking a look at, too. So the first thing we're going to do is look at black conservatives that we can support. We are also going to look at conservatives that we can support, okay? Because a lot of times what conservatives get hit with are these racist narratives from the left. And very often they go unanswered. They are not going to go unanswered anymore. We are going to push back. We're going to push back hard, obviously depending on the resources that we're able to garner for this. But our plan is to push back hard when conservatives get hit with these racial narratives. Also, our conservative media figures, okay? They come under attack with this racist crap from the left. And the left organizes and tries to affect their sponsors and their advertisers and everything else. We are going to be ready. When this crap happens again, we are fighting back on behalf of our conservative media figures who bear so much of this hatred and these narratives, these ugly narratives from the left. So we want to be the voice of pushback. Now, yeah, on the more positive side, there are Democrats, like I just mentioned, in Florida, who bucked their own party so that they could help their own people with school choice. And you know what? If need be, if the only way that we can advance the cause to make sure that some of these issues that affect our country in terms of black folk, look, I'm not beyond saying we would help them too. I'm still thinking about how we would do that, because first things first, we have to get conservatives in. We have to make sure this president is reelected. Those are my number one priorities. And then we have to help our conservatives. We have to stand ready to defend our conservative media heroes. And I don't say this to blow smoke up your skirt, Derek, but like you, I mean, you are unafraid to speak out. You're unafraid to speak the truth. So what happens to guys like you? You guys become the target. And I've seen this. You know I've seen this from where I sit.
Yeah.
From time after time after time, these organizations that are no more than a handful of people that know how to use technology, that know how to use bots, that know how to make their presence look a lot larger, go out and try to hit advertisers, try to hit sponsors to shut up our media figures. Well, it's time we shut them down, okay? So when they come out with this racist nonsense, we want to be ready to go totally 100% on the offense, not hoping.
What was your reaction in 2016 when Donald Trump went to Detroit and gave the famous "What the hell do you have to lose?" speech? Because I know that scared the hell out of the left. Donna Brazile wrote about it in her book, and she quickly ripped off an op-ed. Juan Williams wrote a whole book about it. It scared Democrats that Republicans were at least putting overtures out there and throwing out the $84,000 question, or whatever the hell the pyramid is now, $64,000 question, where what do you have to lose? How could things get any worse? When you saw that as a conservative, did you think, finally somebody gets it, or did you think it was a? I mean, what was your reaction to that moment?
What Donald Trump has done, so many things that I love about it. First of all, Donald Trump doesn't give a rat's butt.
You can say whatever you want. You can say it however you want. Ass.
He doesn't give a rat's ass whether you are black, whether you're white, whether you're whatever. If you come after him, he's coming back at you, and he's coming back at you hard. That's one of the things I love about him. And he doesn't care. He's the first Republican male I've seen in ages that's an elected politician that's not scared when some black guy says something that's crooked and off the reservation to him. He comes and slams him completely back down. And all the other Democrats are, ooh, what a racist, ooh, what. He doesn't care. He just nails them anyway. Guess what, guys? For the timid Republicans who walk around with your tail between your leg, scared that somebody's going to call you racist, stand up and take notice. This is how you do it. You fight back. You don't back down from these people. You continue to elevate your position as hard as you can, and you don't give them a quarter because they don't give you one.
Let me ask you about the recruiting process, because one of the things that drives me nuts about the conservative movement, we may have talked about this in the past, is the sort of purity test. There seems to be a lot of peacocking around it. True conservatism is this, true conservatism is that. You're not really a conservative. You're not really a conservative. There's a lot of circular firing squads, but it's more of a slap fight, really. But when it comes to recruiting candidates, especially in blue districts where, like Gregory Meeks, who was in the news this week for spreading a lot of money around a campaign when he doesn't have an opponent. He spent almost $750,000. You got a situation where you could recruit a candidate who is, say, conservative on school choice, on education issues, but on other issues, they're just not. They're just not. Is it too early to think that there should be some sort of bar and just be happy with getting somebody out there? Or is there a criteria that they'll have to meet in order to get the New Journey PAC's sort of at least shine?
Look, here's my philosophy, and Archer and I have talked about this. If we get 70 to 80% of what we want in the candidate, we're good with it. There are certain places, and especially in areas like, look, Gregory Meeks is my mom's congressman. I know him. I've confronted him about stuff in the past, okay? And by the way, Gregory Meeks is also a nice guy, but that doesn't have anything to do with his politics, right? Okay? Very nice guy, but has nothing to do with his politics. There are black Republicans, by the way, finally coming back into some of those areas. One is running against AOC in her district, the part of her district that leans into Queens. So in answer to your question, look, I'm not running around with this conservative purity test. I know exactly what you mean. If we get 80% of what we want, if we get more than half the loaf, we're cool. We're gonna go. We need to win. You can have all these purity tests in the world you want. What good does it do when you've lost the House? What good is that going to do us if we lose the Senate? First, we need the numbers so that we can prevail most of the time. That's politics. Nobody prevails all of the time. We need enough numbers so we can prevail most of the time and do what they do. Keep coming back until you get everything you want.
Are you prepared for the literal storm of feces that's going to come your way? Not just because of the organization that you're starting, but because of where you work. I guarantee you that the bridge trolls that work in the basement at Media Matters, they're now staffing up. They've got somebody who's going to scroll through your Twitter feed. They're going to find you on Facebook. They're going to find every email that you've ever sent to anybody. And then they're going to make sure that you guys at New Journey PAC follow the letter of the law to a T, to a degree that the government doesn't even do it. Are you guys prepared for that? Because you already sort of had a bullseye on you to begin with because of your job, but now you're stepping out from behind and becoming the front to this thing.
Yes, number one, that's one of the reasons I said transparency. We've talked about that in the run-up to this. We are going to do everything by the letter of the law, not just the letter of the law, the spirit of the law. Okay, that's number one. Number two, let them come at me. I've been called every name in the book. I don't care. You can call me whatever names you want to call me, because guess what? I'm going to call you a few back. And if you come at me, I'm coming back at you too. So we're on notice with each other. Come at me, I'm coming back at you.
So how can people get involved? What do you want from people? You're doing publicity this week because the organization just launched. And I think there's nobody who's listening who isn't going, yeah, right on. Hell yeah. It's about damn time. Let's do this thing. Let's do it right. But that doesn't get anybody anywhere. A nice round of applause is great, but it subsides pretty quickly. What do you want the next steps to be as people learn about this?
We have to raise money. Money is the mother's milk of politics. This is the part that I felt most uncomfortable with, but you know what? Got to get over it. Okay? So I'm going to have to now join this race for donors and donations and all of that. You know, it's hard when you grow up and you're told never to ask people for money.
Right.
But when you're in an organization like this and you're in the political world, you have to ask for money. So in order to succeed, until we can do what I want to do ultimately, by the way, which is to turn some of what we're going to do with content into profit-making ventures, so then we can support ourselves. But in this initial stage of newjourneypac.org, we have to raise money. We also have a community site that we're building called MAGA.black. MAGA.black. And that's where we hope to do a lot of content development. We're already talking. We've got some exciting things that we're lining up right now that'll be kind of fun for the campaign, and also kind of surprising. We've got permission from a well-known entertainer that we can publicize the fact that he's a conservative. And so we're working that out right now.
You can just say my name. I've given you permission.
Thank you, Gary. Okay. And so this is going to be an adventure. You know, it's going to be an adventure. I'm unafraid, you know. If people come at me, they come at me. If they come at us, they come at us. But we have to do the right thing here. What we want is for the best of for people. We're not doing this to make enemies. We're not doing this to be an enemy. We're doing this so that we can grow up in a country, Derek, where your kids can grow up and not be called a racist just because they happen to believe public policy should be this way or that way. We want to grow. We want to have your kids and my kids and my grandchildren, if I ever have any, if grow up in a country where they're not going to be called Uncle Toms or foul names because they dare to think for themselves with the brain that God gave them, and why should they suffer these vile insults from people just because they want to use their brains, just because they want to get ahead? So we have to be unafraid as we move forward with this. And that's what we intend to do. We're just going to move forward with this.
What do you think, just out of curiosity, what do you think carries the more weight or has lost the most weight? Being called a racist or being called an Uncle Tom? Because I think racist has been cried so many times that there's still racism out there, but it gets lost in the, well, you're opposed to Obamacare, that's because you're a racist. Whereas Uncle Tom seems much more personal, and it is. I know you've been called that at least three or four times in your life, but that's much more personal and carries much more weight, particularly in the black community. The white people, I think, are, especially white conservatives, are kind of used. It's not a day that ends in Y unless we're called a racist because of something we don't agree with politically with Democrats.
Yeah, well, see, the Uncle Tom thing to me is so old. I mean, I don't even, if that's all you have, I mean, that's, when somebody calls me that, I'm like, seriously, is that all you have? I mean, your brain can't function on a higher plane than that? There's nothing new here. Bring me something new. So, no, both of them have lost their stink. Calling people racist, sadly, you can call, everything's racist. Everybody's racist. Everything's racist.
That's racist and, say that. That's just racist to say.
Right.
All right. I have to pick your brain on a couple of things in the news just because I have the opportunity to talk to you, and texting you doesn't really translate well to a podcast. We had the big vote. Nancy Pelosi came out today. She parked her broom. She came out. She railed against how she's mad that somebody dropped a house on her sister. And then she said, without specifying what the articles of impeachment would be, that she's calling on the House, basically the Judiciary Committee, to move forward with articles of impeachment. It's as nebulous as you possibly can get. But it also, I'm slightly surprised that they went this far. But they're also pot committed at this point. Have Democrats painted themselves into a corner?
Yes, but I'm surprised you're surprised they went this far.
I'm surprised they did it so – I thought they wanted to flirt with it and try and keep people stringing along rather than actually – you know, jump. A lot of people hang out on the cliff in Acapulco. Very few of them actually jump in, but they all talk a good game. And now Nancy Pelosi's ready to cannonball.
Okay, who's your, you know, you're from Michigan. Who's that congresswoman from up there? Rashida Tlaib.
Yeah, she represents where I actually grew up.
Well, see, haha, you got one too. Okay.
Nowhere I've lived has been Republican. It's been horrible. I went to Elijah Cummings' district after that, so, you know, what do I know?
Love it. So what did Rashida tell us early on?
Yeah, we're going to impeach the mother scratcher.
Yeah, we're going to impeach the mother. Yeah, that's what she said. What has Al Green been honking about ever since he can? We're going to impeach him. What has Maxine been talking about? Maxine says confront all those Trump people in the street, code language. Why don't you beat up Trump supporters and let's find some way to impeach him. The left has wanted to impeach Donald Trump ever since he came down the elevator. Election night, it was cast in stone. The moment that they got through crying when they found out Hillary lost, the next thought was, okay, we got to impeach this guy. And nothing is, this is all playbook. And now, when they impeach him, it will go to the Senate. He will be found not guilty. They will go back to their crazed base and say, well, we did our best, so please don't vote against us. And hopefully, we gain even more seats in the Senate. If we really are focused and we focus on those 30 congressmen and Democrat congressmen in districts where Trump won, we can use this to politically bludgeon them, and flip the House back, only this time, hopefully, with a Speaker of the House that actually has the president's back instead of trying to stick a knife into it.
Yeah, it would be nice to have a Speaker of the House with contents in their underpants for a change. But that's one of the things that drives me most nuts, and I know because of the emails that I get from people who listen and watch this show, is that Republicans are really, really good in the abstract. As a minority party, look, I thought that I was fully expecting them to blow it in these impeachment hearings, just from a narcissism point of view, where they're like, the world is watching. Here's my 5 minutes to shine. I'm going to give a 4.5-minute speech, maybe ask a half-hearted question, and just move on. But they didn't. They actually seemed to have a strategy that worked, that was smart, that sticks with it. But then you remember back 2 years ago, all the way back to 2010 or the Bush years, when Republicans had control over everything. And while they had the opportunity to do the things that they swore to us up and down my whole life that they wanted to do, reduce the size of government, give people some choices in Social Security and Medicare, things like that, choices, not mandated change, they not only didn't do it, they didn't try to do it. Whereas for generations, Democrats have been pushing towards socialized medicine, inching towards that, expanding Medicaid up, lowering the Medicare age down, so on and so forth. Republicans, why are Republicans so damn bad when the voters call their bluff, elect them, and say, this stuff you've been saying is great, go do it. And then they're kind of stuck there like, I don't know what to do, or I don't really want to do this. So that sort of disheartens voters a lot, I know, because I hear from people who get pissed off when Republicans have a shot to do the right thing that with real teeth, legislative teeth, and they don't do it.
This is why I think President Trump's ascendancy is so vital. From now on, if you have Republicans that go back to that old model, oh, yes, we're going to repeal Obamacare on day one, and they don't repeal it. Oh, yes, we're going to fix immigration. And instead, they listen to the Chamber of Commerce and are fearful of doing anything that the president wanted to do on it. The president has, especially now if he wins re-election and has a chance to really expand the type of congressman that he's bringing in on his coattails. The Senate's a little bit more of a wash, but the House is where we have a lot of opportunity to make gains and get and really enlarge the amount of conservative congressmen that are in the House. That's why it's vital to have conservatives in there. Look, I believe in the big tent. You know, I'm not mad at Susan Collins when Susan Collins does a Susan Collins. You know, she's Susan Collins.
Right.
She's gonna do a Susan Collins. But guess what? On some real important things, Susan Collins is going to be with you. I'm not mad at her. But we need more conservatives in the House where the spending and appropriations happen and where we can shape a lot more policy that's going to go to the Senate. Even if it gets watered down in conference reports, we need to have – when you're watering down an already moderate bill, you're left with nothing. When you're trying to water down to get past the Senate a 90% conservative bill, well, you're going to get some of your objectives, and then you keep going back for more and keep going back for more. Incrementalism, like Democrats have done it over the years. So I think that President Trump has lit a fire under this party to show a lot of the people in this base and the races that are closest to home, conservatives, either you play ball or we're going to send you home in the primary. I hope that's what's going to happen this cycle.
That would be nice. James, we have to do that podcast we talked about how I point out to the world you're wrong about music and how Jimi Hendrix is probably the most overrated guitarist in history. We have to get together and do that. We should have just recorded that conversation. But the website, again, is newjourneypac.org. And then the other one is MAGA, M-A-G-A dot black. Is that right?
That's right.
And you can get all of that. You're at Bo Snerdley on Twitter?
Yeah, I am.
And you should harass him every single day to get me to guest host for Rush Limbaugh. And I don't know, send him tasteful nudes as well. Either one, I think, is the way to go. James, Bo, always a pleasure to talk to you, my friend. Best of luck. And let's check in a couple of months and see if we can maybe do a status update on this organization, because I think it's wildly important.
Thank you, Derek. Thank you so much. And believe it or not, folks, he's really a good friend.
All right, we'll release the hostage. Thank you, James. Oh. That's all the time we have for today. And this week, it's Friday. Let's go get drunk. We'll see you here on Monday. Have a good one.